When running a computer program, we generate data that has to be stored in memory. We represent the resource usage by depicting a rectangle. Each chunk of data has a specific start point and a specific end point. This is depicted on the x-axis. Therefore, the width of the rectangle represents the total duration of the needed memory allocation. The memory is depicted on the y-axis. Therefore, the height of the rectangle represents the memory usage. Since we have limited memory, we cannot allocate all the data that we would like to allocate. We therefore assign a value to the data. We can think of it as an amount of money that we collect if we are able to allocate the data. We depict the amount of available memory by two lines, one at the bottom and one at the top. The storage allocation problem is not restricted to allocating memory. From now on, we therefore talk about tasks and we do not talk about memory anymore. We now consider an instance of the storage allocation problem. An instance of the storage allocation problem can be composed of many tasks. These tasks may not overlap. We may therefore imagine a special version of Tetris where we stack these tasks on top of each other. The difference is that we can choose a subset of tasks and we can also choose the ordering in which they appear. The goal is to choose a subset of tasks that maximizes the overall weight. A feasible solution has to stay within the capacity. For example, if we add the red task, we obtain an invalid solution. We therefore cannot keep all of the tasks and we have to remove some of them. One property that makes the storage allocation problem particularly difficult is that the order of tasks matters. In the given example, we may rearrange the tasks and then we are able to schedule all of them. If the capacity is depicted by just a straight line, we talk about a uniform capacity. However, it does not have to be a straight line, it can be also more complicated. We can see the storage allocation problem, or SAP for short, as a combination of two well-studied problems. The first problem is called unsplittable flow in a pass, UFP. And the second problem is called the two-dimensional geometric knapsack problem. The definition of UFP is very similar to the one of SAP. The difference is that the tasks do not have to be depicted as rectangles, but they can be pushed all the way to the bottom. We can imagine a resource like electrical power or water. In the two-dimensional geometric knapsack problem, we have rectangles just like in SAP. But now, instead of moving the tasks only up and down, we may also move them to the left or to the right. For both problems, until recently, the best approximation ratio was 2 plus epsilon. And for both problems, this has changed recently. There is a 5 over 3 plus epsilon approximation for UFP, and there is a 17 over 9 plus epsilon approximation algorithm for the two-dimensional geometric knapsack problem. We now come to the known results for SAP. For uniform edge capacity, the first approximation algorithm with a constant approximation ratio was the 7 approximation by Barnoy et al. This was later improved to a 2 plus epsilon approximation by Bar-Yehuda et al. For general instances, the first approximation algorithm with a constant approximation ratio was the 9 plus epsilon approximation by Bar-Yehuda et al. And the best known result is a 2 plus epsilon approximation that we presented at ICALP 2015. An important note is that the 2 plus epsilon approximation is the best result for both uniform edge capacities and arbitrary edge capacities. And even if we allow quasi-polynomial running time, there was no better algorithm known before. In contrast, for UFP, there is a 1 plus epsilon approximation in quasi-polynomial time. We were now able to overcome some of the difficulties that held us back from obtaining a better than 2 approximation algorithm previously. Our first main result is a 63 over 32 plus epsilon approximation, which is smaller than 1.969, which works for uniform instances and which runs in polynomial time. Our second main result is a 1.997 approximation algorithm for much more general instances where we have quasi-polynomially bounded capacities. The algorithm runs in quasi-polynomial time. As a reminder, quasi-polynomial means that asymptotically we have a number n to the polylog n. The problem becomes easier if we allow resource augmentation. The problem becomes easier to handle if we allow resource augmentation. That means that we as the algorithm are allowed to use all the capacity until the dashed line on top, but the optimal solution still has to stay underneath the real capacity profile. That means the solid line, the top solid line in the picture. If we allow resource augmentation, we are able to obtain a 3 over 2 plus epsilon approximation, which is roughly 1.5 in polynomial time. And if we allow quasi-polynomial running time, then we obtain a 1 plus epsilon approximation, which is the best that we can hope for. The key difficulty for solving SAP comes from the distinction of small tasks and large tasks. Intuitively, we can imagine small tasks as tasks that have a small demand. So a small task can be very long, then it can still be small because the demand is small. And if the demand is large, then we have a large task. Formally, small means that the demand of a task I is smaller or equal mu times the capacity, and large means that the demand is greater or equal delta times the capacity, where mu and delta are two constants that are far apart from each other. If you wonder about the task between mu and delta, there's a random shift argument such that we can remove those tasks. If we have general capacities, we have to be a little bit more careful with the definition of capacity. In the uniform case, the capacity is simply a number. But in the general case, we have to be a little bit more careful. There we have to talk about something called the bottleneck capacity. The bottleneck capacity of a task I, B of I, is the smallest capacity within its range. And a task is small if it's smaller or equal mu times its bottleneck capacity, and it's large if it's larger or equal delta times its bottleneck capacity. If we restrict our attention to only those tasks that are small, then it's known that there is a 1 plus epsilon approximation that we can achieve in polynomial time. The same is true if we have only large tasks. And the difficulty now is to combine large and small tasks. Intuitively, the reason why it is so hard to combine small and large tasks is that if we place large tasks, then the remaining capacity is very small. And relative to the remaining capacity, the small tasks appear actually to be large. We now discuss how we can get an approximation ratio better than 2. A key property that every algorithm has to have is to combine large and small tasks. For clarity of the argument, we do not talk about tasks that are between large and small tasks. So to be precise everywhere, we would have to add an epsilon, but we do not do that here. On the left-hand side, the blue bar depicts the overall weight of large tasks in an optimal solution. The red bar on the right-hand side depicts the overall weight of small tasks in an optimal solution. And since we assume that there are no tasks in between, if we get exactly half of the weight of large tasks of an optimal solution, and we get exactly half of the weight of small tasks of an optimal solution, then overall we get half of the weight. And half of the weight means that we obtain a 2 approximation, because 1 over 1 half is 2. Now imagine we obtain more than 1 half on each side at the same time. That means that we increase the weight that we obtain compared to opt for the small task and for the large task simultaneously. Then the approximation ratio improves, and if we get all the large and all the small tasks, then we have an optimal solution, the approximation ratio is 1. Equivalently, if we decrease the rate, then the approximation ratio goes to infinity. Intuitively, what the known 2 plus epsilon approximation algorithm was able to achieve was to either collect all small tasks or all large tasks. The worst case happens if the weight of the large tasks equals the weight of the small tasks. Therefore, we assume that the weight of large tasks in an optimal solution equals the weight of small tasks in an optimal solution. And what we can see now is that if we are able to get the full profit of small tasks and even a tiny profit from the large tasks additionally, then we improve over the approximation ratio too. The same is true if we get the full profit of large tasks and just a small profit from the small tasks of opt, then we also improve over the approximation ratio too. In order to improve over the factor 2, we subdivided the large tasks and the small tasks into specific groups of tasks. And for each of these groups, we were able to do something sensible. Therefore, one of the main contributions of our work was to identify the right subproblems that were actually solvable and that were contributing towards a good solution. A key building block for obtaining our result are boxed solutions. In a boxed solution, we create boxes for the small tasks. And if we were able to put the small tasks into the right boxes and we knew exactly which boxes we need, then we could simply see these boxes as large tasks and find an almost optimal solution. There are two key difficulties with boxed solutions. The first difficulty is that the number of boxes that we need on top of each other can be more than a constant. The second key difficulty is that even if we know the boxes, we don't know which tasks go into which box, because it can be that two boxes on top of each other can hold the same small tasks. In particular, we do not even know which small tasks should go into the boxes and which small tasks should not go into the boxes. If we were having only a single box, then we would be able to compute an almost optimal solution for that box. So if we are in the special case that at each point in time there are only constantly many boxes on top of each other, then we still can get a true approximation for the small tasks and we can get virtually all of the large tasks. In order to overcome these difficulties, we identified different types of boxed solutions and different parts of the instance that can be solved with these different types of solutions. In each of these cases, we either obtain almost the full profit of large tasks and some profit of the small tasks, or we obtain almost the full profit of small tasks and some profit of the large tasks. We start with our result for uniform capacities, which from a practical perspective is the most important case. We now continue with an overview of types of box solutions that we identified. One of these box solutions are laminar box solutions. In a laminar box solution, the subpaths of the boxes form a laminar family. That means that the boxes do not cross each other. The box is either entirely contained in the other box or it is disjoint. This means that if we look at the picture, you build up towers that monotonously get thinner to the top and that do not have overhangs. The boxes have additional properties. They have to get larger towards the top. From bottom to the top, the demand of these boxes has to increase exponentially. We want to apply a dynamic program to identify the boxes, and we do not want to lose too much when filling them. So intuitively, if we are at a large box at the top, the bottom boxes are so small that we can forget about them. This is important because there are two nested dynamic programs, one going from left to right, one going from bottom to top, and we are not able to store the full history. Therefore, we have to be able to forget some parts. And intuitively, we can forget parts that have a very small demand. As a result, we can obtain the optimal profit of the large tasks and almost half of the profit of the small tasks. The next type of solution are pileboxable solutions. They are somewhat similar to laminar boxable solutions. We can arrange boxes and piles from bottom to top such that the boxes on top have paths entirely contained in the paths of the boxes underneath. Another difference to laminar boxable solutions is that the sizes of the boxes does not vary within the instance. There is a fixed size and there are only constantly many boxes on top of each other. If there is a pileboxable solution, then we can compute a solution which obtains a full profit of the large tasks and almost the full profit of the small tasks. The final type of solution are gemmed solutions. Intuitively, we have a bunch of large tasks, and the small tasks are gemmed in between the large tasks. There is a horizontal line at B1 and a horizontal line at B2. Let us take a closer look at the instance. Let us consider the large task in the middle of E1. This task reaches most up among the large tasks of E1. And B1 is the value at the top of that task. Therefore, the horizontal line is right on top of the large tasks in the bottom. Therefore, the yellow area depicts the free space between the line and the top large tasks. And this area forms a new SAP instance. And the gemmed solution has a property that the small tasks that potentially fit into that area are large compared to the free space. There may be more than one of these mini instances. In this picture, there are two, with subpath E1 and subpath E2. What is important is that these subpaths may not overlap. If there is a gemmed solution, we can compute also a solution that almost reaches the full profit. If there is a gemmed solution, we can compute a solution that achieves almost the full profit of the large tasks and of the small tasks. Our structural lemma for uniform capacities says that these four types of solutions are sufficient to obtain a 63 over 32 plus epsilon approximation. More precisely, it states the existence of special types of solutions. Either a boxable solution, where each edge is contained in at most constantly many boxes, such that all large tasks and half of the small tasks gives the approximation that we aim for. Or there exists a laminar boxable solution, such that all the large tasks and half of the small tasks are sufficient to get the approximation that we aim for. Or there is an O of 1 pile boxable solution, where the entire profit gives a 63 over 32 approximation, or there's a gemmed solution that gives a 63 over 32 approximation. In each case, we are able to compute exactly such a solution. The four types of boxable solutions of the structural lemma appear if we look at certain arrangements of solutions. We consider three different arrangements. Either all of the small tasks are in a small strip at the bottom, or all of the small tasks are in a small strip at the top, or the strip at the bottom and the strip at the top are completely free. We now move to our result for quasi-polynomial capacities. Since we claim quasi-polynomial running time and not polynomial running time, we do not have to distinguish the same cases as for uniform capacities. We only distinguish boxable solutions and stare points. The boxable solutions are partitioned in different types of boxable solutions. There are top points, bottom points, and sandwich points. We can imagine top points and bottom points as mirror images of each other. A top point is delimited by a line in the bottom and by a profile in the top. The profile is formed by large tasks and the original profile of the instance. A sandwich point is only delimited by large tasks in the top and in the bottom. By removing tasks with small enough profit, we can handle these three types of points. In all three cases, we obtain boxable solutions, where for each edge there are only polylogarithmically many boxes. All of these solutions have sufficient profit. A stare point is somewhat different. A stare point is delimited at the top by the capacity profile and in the bottom by a set of large tasks. Since the large tasks may have a large value, we cannot remove them. Since we are not able to create extra space, stare points give us the most difficult situation. But stare points have an interesting structure. There is a vertical dashed line that separates the instance into the left-hand side and into a right-hand side. All the small tasks start on the left-hand side and end on the right-hand side of this dashed line. There are no large tasks on the left-hand side, only on the right-hand side. The large tasks are arranged in such a way that they generate a profile from the bottom. Staircase instances are difficult because we really have to consider the large tasks and the small tasks at the same time. The reason is that removing some of the small tasks does not necessarily create space for other small tasks. The reason is that the range of top-down motion of small tasks is limited. To combine small and large tasks in staircase instances, we use a configuration LP. We have a variable for each possible set of large tasks, and we have additional variables for placing the small tasks. The linear program has an exponential number of variables, but we can still separate it via the dual. Interestingly, the separation problem in the dual turns out to be a variant of SAP with only large tasks. We then use the LP values to sample the set of large tasks. In some specific situations, however, we can lose too much profit of the small tasks, and this is something that can happen with too high probability. But in this special situation, we are able to handle the situation by additional constraints, such that in this special situation, we obtain sufficient profit from only the small tasks. To conclude, our result shows that the factor 2 is not the last word. This is certainly true in the case of uniform capacities. But also in the case of quasi-polynomial capacities, our result shows that it is unlikely that the factor 2 is the last word. Our results therefore give new evidence that there might be a PTAS for the storage allocation problem, and the main open question for this problem is to find a PTAS. We also obtained new evidence that a PTAS is likely for general capacities. In particular, we obtain a PTAS if we allow resource augmentation and quasi-polynomial running time. One of our main technical contributions was a linear programming-based approach to deal with staircase instances. And this approach might have implications beyond the storage allocation problem, because it's a new method to combine large tasks and small tasks. And the combination of large tasks and small tasks is not restricted to the storage allocation problem. This is a reoccurring problem in many different types of packing problems, and it might be possible to adapt our technique to other packing problems. We therefore hope that this technique is useful for you. Thank you for your attention.